HTS number is not on the list on either federal agency or private entity list. Therefore, we are looking for an exception. It is an exception. Identification of the point of contact at the agency. Now, here is the interesting part. Customs examiners here are saying allegations by the public. Here you have allegation by federal agency, which is apparently public agency. And here we have allegation by the interested party, which is not a federal agency. Only federal agency has the identification of the point of contact, right here. And here you do have to identify yourself, right? You have to provide the contact information, you have to provide the identification of who you are, on whose behalf you are doing this. So I think this question would be better phrased by substituting public to the federal agency. But customs examiners, again, some of the questions, they are not well phrased, and we just have to do with what we have. So keep that in mind, that it's not easy to pinpoint based on the fact pattern stated, right? Public, right? What is public? Then it is better to stick to exact word-for-word line items. And here we have exact word-for-word, because customs examiners, what they probably have done is they took out the stuff directly from the Code of Federal Regulations and copied and pasted this into the answer choices provided. They could have truncated the provisions, but nevertheless, they remained intact, those buzzwords, right? So you stick to the buzzwords, and if the buzzword is not on the list, that would be an exception. Here, it would be harmonized tariff schedule number. All right, moving on. Initiation of investigation. So remember, one of the things I mentioned, one of the things I talked about is the TIF that provided by the Enforce and Protect Act is they imposed the requirement to respond. And the requirement to respond within the federal agency context means sticking to the deadlines, right? So we have this deadline. I think I have the better screenshot. It's in the outline. And right here. So this is the timeline. You have 15 days for to respond to receipt, right? Then you have 90 days to respond for customs to determine what they're going to do with the allegation, right? They have 300 days to do the investigation. Then they have additional 60 days to continue doing investigation. And then they make a decision, and this decision can be challenged, right? So here you have one customs office, Office of Trade Remedy and Law Enforcement. Then you have another customs office, right, where Office of Regulations and Ruling can request a review, right? And there is so it's kind of like the appellate department within customs. And then if appellate department within customs, Office of Regulations and Ruling says no, then you have Court of International Trade, Customs Court, where this decision can be taken. So those are the timelines concerned. Let's take a look at the basic breakdown by the days. So CBP will make a determination on or before 15 days. So so if you remember that initiation check sheet that I brought up over here, allegation initiation. So if you didn't follow through and you did not include some part, CBP may, for procedural reasons, say no, which means you go back to the drawing board and you decide to say, all right. Or CBP may, for substantive reasons, say, no, we are not going to initiate this because you fail to meet certain criteria, like our standard of review criteria. And after we are done through the outline, we'll take a look at some of the initiation letters which give you a clue of what criteria is fit for initiation, what criteria does not fit for initiation. So now let's go back to the outline. So 15 business days to respond, right? You have, so investigation criteria, and those, I outlined the buzzwords. Again, this is a new field. So those buzzwords, I think, are likely candidates for customs examiners to test, to test examinees on. And again, It's just based on customs tradition to pick out certain buzzwords and ask examinees. So here we have reasonable suggestion, right? As a buzzword when customs is trying to determine whether to to initiate or not to initiate investigation. Criteria, this is another buzzword, reasonable suspicion, right? So reasonable. So everything must be reasonable. Of course, it's difficult to pin down the precise definition of reasonable, because what's reasonable to one may not be reasonable to another. But that's another story. Focus on the buzzwords at this point. Non-determination criteria, meaning that we will not proceed. CBP will not initiate investigation if there is a clerical error or allegation is withdrawn. Notice, allegation is withdrawn. What does it mean? That's a very interesting position. So clerical error, meaning that you mistype something and therefore no entry, like type 3 entry was not declared, you declared type 1 entry, so no anti-dumping involved, and that was because there was some omission in documentation, there was some miscommunication, there was a fat finger, there was a system error. So if you can, if it's not intentional, if it's not negligence, right, if it's not what customs like to call a standard or gross negligence, right, or gross negligence is like wanton disregard. You close your eyes and it's like, okay, there is too many things happening, but I just pretend like I'm not seeing them. That would be like gross negligence. And fraud, of course, it requires intent. You intentionally want to make a run and run around in an illegal kind of way. So a negligence is falling below the standard of care. There is a standard of care, customs has a whole publication out, reasonable care, and where they say, okay, there is that reasonably prudent licensed customs broker which must act in a certain way. And if you do not act like that reasonably prudent licensed customs broker, that means you fall below the standard, and that means that you are negligent. So those are the concepts. That I know they are legal concepts, they are terms of art, but clerical error means that it's not negligence, it's not gross negligence, it's not fraud. I talk more about those negligence concepts in a section called FPNF, fines, forfeitures and fines, penalties and forfeitures chapter. So for more heavier discussion about those legal standards, please refer to that chapter. Essentially clerical error, no investigation. Allegation of withdrawal, right? Allegation is withdrawn, I'm sorry. That means that one of the things that I may want to do is ask whoever made that allegation to withdraw the allegation, and that will end the investigation. At least that's what it looks like, which means that if I say, okay, if I go to the party and I tell the party, listen, can we make an agreement where if without admitting any wrongdoing whatsoever, I give you a certain sum of money and you take that money and then you go to customs and you take your allegation out based on non-determination criteria in the Code of Federal Regulations, customs will not proceed. Is that a possibility? I do not know. It seems to be an interesting one with various repercussions, which goes to the core values of our culture, right? Core values of our society, values of capitalism, values of free market enterprise. It raises a bunch of things. So to me, this is most interesting portion of the whole outline. But I do not. But I mentioned here in the passing because I do not see how it will play out in a public sphere because a lot of the stuff is done in the confidential way, in a confidential manner. Interim measures. So provided that customs says, okay, we do have a reasonable suspicion. So we're going to go and proceed and make that investigation. They will impose interim measures, which will include suspension of liquidation for the entries, which took place on or after the date of initiation of investigation. So even though you declare them as non-anti-dumping duties or incorrectly declaring them as anti-dumping duties with a different duty rate, customs will say, no, we're going to suspend liquidation on those entries pending the investigation. And liquidation, there is a whole chapter on liquidation too, it basically means the final computation of duties. In case of anti-dumping, the duties are retroactive, which means that the final computation of duties, so you pay when you in a regular duties world, right? You don't know the HTS. You have, let's say, 5% duties for some article of plastic, and you make a contract. You know this is will be part of your cost to pay 5% duties, and as long as you bring it on a certain date, you know that the duties will not change. It may change. There is the tariff reduction, various scheduled tariff reduction. That pretty much you know that 5% will be 5%. For the anti-dumping, it's a different story. Anti-dumping duties are what's called retroactive duties. That means they have this look back provision. So, but pretty much it works like this: you bring in polyethylene retail carrier bags, you know, like plastic grocery bags from China, which are subject to anti-dumping duties. The moment you bring them, they will be X amount of duty. But by the time the entry liquidates, the duty can change. The duty can change because there may be a period of review initiated by the Department of Commerce, which will review the period of imports during which you imported those retail carrier bags, those grocery bags, and they will determine that, listen, our normal value has changed. It's actually, remember the anti-dumping duty is the difference between the value offered for export, right, and the normal value. So for that period, Department of Commerce recalculates the normal value, and they say, well, hold on, difference has increased, so the margin is much higher. So instead of x, you'll be play, you may be paying x plus 100 or 50 or whatever. And that's what retroactive. So the issue order, so okay, for this period, liquidation instructions to customs is not x, but x plus 50. This is what I mean by retroactive application. So now it has another level of uncertainty because extension for the period of liquidation for unliquidated entries that were entered before the date of the investigation. So you not only have this period of review, right? The shipper, it's called shipper review, right? There is sunset reviews which occur every 5 years. I'm talking about the ship review, which occur every year. If no ship review is requested, then the liquidation will take place at the amount which was set at the, from the beginning. But because we deal in the world of retroactivity, that can change. So on top of that, you have another layer, right? You extending the liquidation even though the review period has gone by and the duties were settled. And you also can have something which has been often tested by the licensed customs brokers, which is a licensed customs broker exam, which is the concept of live entry. The concept of live entry deals with instead of bringing merchandise and paying later, you have to pay upfront, and instead of having a bond, you have to usually pay a cash deposit for the anti-dumping. Those are serious stuff, and those interim measures can mean a higher cost of doing business, can really act or affect in a negative type of way the businesses with respect to which those measures, interim measures, were taken. All right, so interim measures, no later than 90 days after initiating an investigation. So the 90-day rule, be mindful of that. Then I bring another that 90-day. Remember that the chart that I talked about. That's 90-day rule over here. Customs likes to test on days, so be mindful of those days. And then we have notice of initiation. Sounds like this closed society, you know, like initiation, like ritual, right? So here we have another ritual, right, which customs goes through, and it adopts this cryptic initiation verbiage as a part of one. 165.15. Please note that this language, those rules, right, the 95-day rule, 5-day rule, is taken from this section. So be mindful of that so you can cross-correlate, because customs examiners are also asking and testing on the section. They will say, which section can you find that 5-business-day rule for interim measures? There will be this bunch of sections. And awareness of you that we're talking about 165.15 will help you out. So CPB will issue notification of its decision to initiate or not initiate investigation no later than 95 calendar days after decision no later than 5 business days after the interim measures are taken. Who is covered by investigation? What is covered by investigation? Well, how far can you reach back for those entries? Well, 1 year old. And 1 year old before the receipt of allegation through pendency of investigation. So while investigation is going, and we talked about this 300 plus 60, plus possible 60 days, right? While this is going, plus 1 year. As an example, and this is taken from the real letter, interested party filed allegation on August 1st. CBP acknowledged the receipt of property, so everything was done correctly, on August 7th. Do you go back 1 year from August 1st or August 7th? You go back from August 7 through pendency investigation. Just to drive a point home, I think that an example would be helpful. All right, time for investigation. So that 300-day rule we talked about, 60 calendar day additional if stuff are complicated can also take place.